Hello everybody, this is Jörg once again from YouTube channel Joggler66, Hour of the Truth, with another reading of Babylon Mystery Religion from Ralph Woodrow. We have come to chapter 7 and I'm very sorry that it has been such a long time since the last reading, but I will see to get through this book now as fast as possible because I'm very much looking forward to my next English project after I finished Rulers of Evil, which I'm still making a little video series from a summary in German right now, as many people probably have seen already. The first two videos are out for the moment, today on the 28th of February, and I'll get on with that, and I will also make an epilogue kind of summary of the same book, Rulers of Evil, in English in the future. But after that, I have a new project, a new book waiting that I'm anxious to start. But first, I want to get through Babylon Mystery Religion. So, here it comes, Chapter 7, Constantine and the Cross. As you probably remember, we were speaking earlier, in an earlier chapter, the one before, about the origins of the cross. And now we have Constantine's vision and Constantine and the cross. An outstanding factor, says the author in the beginning of chapter 7, that contributed to the adoration of the cross image within the Romish church was the famous vision of the cross and Constantine's subsequent, though questionable, conversion. As Constantine and his soldiers approached Rome, they were about to face what is known as the Battle of Milvian Bridge. If you want to learn more about on this historic fact, the Battle of Milvian Bridge, I will put a link in the description box of the video with search results for your own research that you can look that up, what it was all about. It was about a time when Rome had even more than one one emperor and all that stuff. Quite interesting to go through, but too deep to do this in this lecture. According to the custom, the author continues, of the time, the haruspices, those who employed divination by such means as reading the entrails of sacrificial animals, were called to give advice. The Bible records how the king of Babylon had followed the same practice, by the way. Quote, "For the king of Babylon stood at the parting of the way at the head of the two ways to use divination. He made his arrows bright, he consulted with images, he looked in the liver," unquote, as we can check in Ezekiel chapter 21, verse 21. Now in the case of Constantine, he was told that the gods would not come to his aid. Okay, little pause. He was told that the gods would not come to his aid. There's only one God, right? So there already you have to have doubts about this vision, because he invoked so-called the gods through his vision. And who are those gods? Surely not the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob of the Bible. Anyway, he was told that the gods would not come to his aid, that he would suffer defeat in the battle. But then, in a vision or dream, as he related later, there appeared a cross to him, and the words, "In this sign conquer," or as you also know it from many banners all over the world, "In hoc signo vinces." The next day, October 28th, 312 AD, he advanced behind a standard portraying a cross. He was victorious in that battle, defeated his rival, and professed conversion. It is admitted on all sides, however, that Constantine's vision of the cross may not be historically true. That is what is admitted on all sides, and I'm very sure that it is absolutely not historically true. He may have had a vision, but from what spirit, you should ask yourself. The only authority from whom the story has been gathered by historians is Eusebius. But if Constantine did have such a vision, Are we to suppose its author was Jesus Christ? Would the Prince of Peace instruct a S.U.N. sun-worship emperor to make a military banner embodying the cross and to conquer and kill in that sign? The Roman Empire, of which Constantine became the head, has been described in the scriptures as a beast. Daniel saw four great beasts, which represented four world empires. Babylon, presented as a lion, Medo-Persia, presented as a bear, and Greece, presented as a leopard, and Rome. The fourth beast, the Roman Empire, was so horrible that it was symbolized by a beast unlike any other, as we can read for confirmation in Daniel chapter 7, verses 1 through 8. Quote, "In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heavens strove upon the great sea. And four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion, and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and made stand upon the feet as a man, and the man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second, like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in the mouth of it between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, Arise, devour much flesh. After this I beheld, and lo, another, like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were 3 of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in his horn were eyes like the eyes of man, and a mouth speaking great things." Unquote. There is, to my mind, not a better description of the Antichrist, the little horn rising out of the 10. Those are the 10 kingdoms that Rome broke up in the time of 476 AD at the fall of the Roman Empire. And there were 3 of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And those, and you can check that historically, and you can check that on my website where I have the videos uploaded in the playlist, Characteristics of Antichrist, where those 3 horns that were plucked up by the roots are being identified as the nations of the Herules, the Ostrogoths, and the Visigoths. And you can listen to that broadcast in the videos Characteristics of Antichrist. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were 3 of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And this horn were eyes like eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. The Antichrist is a man. Always the current pope, the papacy. And because he is a man, he has eyes like a man, and he has a mouth speaking great things, but not so great things biblically, but blasphemy all around. Because the pope says of himself that he is Jesus Christ, hidden under a veil of flesh. And that is a sin not to be forgiven in this life and not to be forgiven in the next life, the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit, who is the real comforter and the real replacement of Jesus Christ on this earth right now. I'm sorry I had to deviate a little bit into that, but I think this is absolutely important. But the author continues that we see no reason to suppose that Christ would tell Constantine to conquer with the sign of the cross to further the beast system of Rome. But if the vision was not of God, how can we explain the conversion of Constantine? Actually, his conversion is questionable, as I stated before, and I don't even think it is questionable. It was just a political move into something that we will mention a little bit later in the reading here. Even though he had much to do with the establishment of certain church practices of the time, the facts plainly show that he was not truly converted, not in the biblical sense of the word anyway. Historians admit that his conversion was, quote, nominal, even by contemporary standards, unquote. Probably the most obvious indication that he was not truly converted may be seen from the fact that after his conversion, he committed several murders, including the murder of his own wife and his own son. According to the Bible, quote, no murderer hath eternal life abiding him, as we can read in 1 John chapter 3, verse 15, quote, whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. And ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Unquote. What's fantastic at this citation of the Bible of John is that you don't even have to take a knife, a gun, a poison, whatever, to kill your brother. When you hate your brother, you're already a murderer. Or when you love one another, you have already fulfilled the commandment, love your neighbor as you love yourself, because love is the fulfilling of the law, and hatred is the exact opposite. By that, it is murder, as in 1 John 3:15 we just read. So when I convert to Christianity and then I murder my own wife and my own son, I think I can hardly call myself a Christian. What can I call myself? I can call myself a Catholic. That I can do, because Catholics are no Christians in the biblical sense. And I am not bashing any Catholic person with saying this, but making you aware of the point how all the people visiting Roman Catholic churches have been betrayed because they are too gullible and refuse to do their own research and read their own Bibles where everything concerning Christianity is written in. First and for all, the 1611 Authorized King James Version Bible. But okay, on the bottom of page 50, the author continues. Constantine's first marriage was to Minervina, by whom he had a son named Crispus. His second wife, Fausta, bore him 3 daughters and 3 sons. So he had 7 children all together. Crispus became an outstanding soldier and help to his father Constantine. Yet, in 326 AD, very shortly after directing the Nicene Council, he had his son put to death. Now, what is about the Nicene Council or the Council of Nicaea? I'm going to give you a little bit explanation on that, and of course you can look that up for yourself on the internet also if you want to read more about it. I'm just reading a little excerpt that you have an idea what the Council of Nicaea was all about. One purpose of the council was to resolve disagreements arising from within the Church of Alexandria over the nature of the Son and his relationship to the Father. We are talking about God, the Father, and his Son in this case. In particular, when the Son had been begotten by the Father from his own being and therefore having no beginning, or else created out of nothing, and therefore having a beginning. What does this mean? It tells us that this, like all future councils of the Church, the so-called Church, the so-called Mother Church, the Roman Catholic Church, are there to interpret Scripture with the understanding of man, not the pure Word of God. The Bible explains itself that that is what true Bible-believing Christians not only believe, but live for. Now, further we read in this important note to explain the Council of Nicaea. Another result of the Council was an agreement on when to celebrate Easter, the most important feast of the ecclesiastical calendar, decreed in an epistle to the Church of Alexandria, in which is simply stated, "We also send you the good news of the settlement concerning the Holy Pasch," coming from the Passover, Pascha feast, "namely that in answer to your prayers, this question also has been resolved. All the brethren in the East who have hitherto followed the Jewish practice will henceforth observe the custom of the Romans, and of yourselves, and of all of us who from ancient times have kept Easter together with you. The Passover, or Pascha, became Easter officially." Isn't that what I've always stated? The pagan Roman Empire baptized itself with the garments of true Christianity, and by this action hijacked Christianity? Another factual proof that Roman Catholicism is not Christianity in the biblical sense of the word Christianity. Now, the author continues, "The story is that Crispus had made love to Fausta." So, means that the son of Constantine's first wife made love to his second wife. What does the Bible say about that anyway? But we deal, of course, with pagans. Huh? At least this was the accusation of Fausta. But this may have been her method to getting him out of the way, so one of her sons might have claimed to the throne. Constantine's mother, however, persuaded him that his wife had yielded to his son. Constantine had Fausta suffocated to death in an overheated bath. About this same time, he had his sister's son flogged to death and her husband strangled, even though he had promised he would spare his life. Probably he relied on mental reservation when breaking his promise. Because we all know that with mental reservation, that is very popular among Roman Catholics, especially Jesuits, who of course didn't exist at the time, but you know, their tradition has an origin, that by mental reservation they can break any promise they did, if it serves their own and of course the Church's purpose. These things are summed up in the following words from the Catholic Encyclopedia. And before I read this, I just want to make a little comment on this. While reading this chapter 7 and the following chapter 8, I will also include in the same video here, there are several quotes coming from the Catholic Encyclopedia. This is what I love about the Antichrist system. Absolutely love it. You can read in their own writings that their teachings are not biblical. So when you call yourself a Christian, what are you doing in that church when even the same church in her own publications admits that they do not adhere to the Word of God? How much more proof do you need? So the Catholic Encyclopedia states, quote, even after his conversion, he caused the execution of his brother-in-law Licinius and of the latter's son, as well as of Crispus, his own son, by his first marriage, and of his wife Fausta. After reading these cruelties, it is hard to believe that the same emperor could at times have mild and tender impulses, but human nature is full of contradictions. End quote. Now, Constantine did show numerous favors toward the Christians, abolished death by crucifixion, and the persecutions which had become so cruel at Rome ceased. Now let me make a little comment on that. What was his real motivation for that action? Meaning to cease the persecutions of the Christians at Rome? All through the first centuries after the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ, the true followers of our Lord had been persecuted, crucified, hanged, burned, fed to wild animals, etc. But the true Christians could not be eradicated. When they killed 10, 100 rose up. When they killed 100, 1,000 rose up. And when they killed 1,000, 10,000 rose up. Here we come to the reasoning why Christianity had to be usurped into the pagan Roman Empire. This true movement of the Holy Spirit could not be defeated, so it had to be infiltrated to be destroyed from within. Exactly what happened after the Reformation with the Protestant churches. They also were infiltrated by the Jesuit order and destroyed from within when the Jesuits took over the seminaries and the leading parts of the church. Did you know that the chairman of the General Congregation of the Seventh-day Adventists today is a Jesuit educated through the seminaries and spiritual exercises by Jesuit educated person, if not a Jesuit himself? Come out of her, my people. There is no so-called denomination. There is no so-called church in this world, organized church in this world, that is of the body of Christ. I could go on for hours on the subject, but I guess you get the gist. In the following sentences now, the author confirms my statement even through the Roman Catholic Church's own encyclopedia. So let's just read on. So now follows a very interesting question. But did he make, Constantine, these decisions purely from Christian convictions, or did he have political motives? Meaning, was his decision spiritual or temporal? Therefore, my dear brethren, I again have to repeat myself when stating that you should never ever forget that the Roman Catholic Church, in the first place, is a political institution and only in the second, a spiritual institution. It is the old pagan Roman civil empire baptized with Christianity. And the ultimate goal of the Vatican is to destroy Christianity. But that would go too far if we discuss this here. But the question the author comes up with, asking, but did he make this decision purely from Christian convictions, or did he have political motives? Quoting again from the Catholic Encyclopedia probably gives us part of the answer. Quote, "Some bishops, blinded by the splendor of the court, even went so far as to laud the emperor as an angel of God, as a sacred being, and to prophesy that he would, like the sons of God, reign in heaven." Apotheosis? Anyone? George Washington in the capital of Rome, being lifted up from man to deity? The same they did here with Emperor Constantine in the 300s, in the 4th century. "It has consequently been asserted," the Catholic Encyclopedia continues, "that Constantine favored Christianity merely from political motives, and he has been regarded as an enlightened despot," enlightened, hello, illumination, "who made use of religion only to advance his policy." Bang! Confirmation from the Roman Catholic Encyclopedia of all the things I've stated before. End quote. Such was the conclusion of the noted historian Durand regarding Constantine. Quote, "Was his conversion sincere? Was it an act of religious belief or a consummate stroke of political wisdom? Probably the latter. He seldom conformed to the ceremonial requirements of Christian worship." His letters to Christian bishops make it clear that he cared little for the theological differences that agitated Christendom, though he was willing to suppress dissent in the interests of imperial unity. Throughout his reign, he treated the bishops as his political aides. He summoned them, presided over their councils, and agreed to enforce whatever opinion their majority should formulate. A real believer would have been a Christian first and a statesman afterwards. Well, a real Christian could never become a statesman, because we have our kingdom of Christ and will not engage in politics in the kingdom that is here of the flesh. My little comment. With Constantine, the author continues, it was reverse. Christianity was to him a means, not an end. The end justifies the means. Where did we hear that again? Isn't that part of the Jesuit oath? Isn't that the policy of the Roman Catholic Church? Everything is allowed as long as it advances the Roman Catholic agenda. The end justifies the means. Well, let's end from the quote. And the author continues, this maxim is generally attributed to the Jesuits, as I just stated. And while it might not be found in just that many words in their authorized books, yet the identical sentiment is found over and over again in their Latin works. And the Jesuits use this to this day. Persecutions had not destroyed the Christian faith. Constantine knew this. Instead of the empire constantly being divided with SU and sun worshippers in conflict with Christians, why not take such steps as might be necessary to mix elements of both religions together, he reasoned, and thereby bring a united force to the empire. What did we just read? To mix elements of both religions together. What does the Bible say? Don't mix the holy with the profane. So when you know that the Roman Catholic Church actually is based on that kind of thinking, is that biblical, I ask you? Now, there were similarities between the two religious systems. Even the cross symbol was not a divisive factor, for by this time it was in use by Christians, and to the worshippers of Mithra and Constantine's forces, the cross could give no offense, for they had long fought under a standard bearing a Mithraic cross of light. Like so many gods, Mithra was the light power behind the sun, the sun. Now, the Christianity of Constantine was a mixture, as we've just read. Though he had his statue removed from sun-worship temples and renounced the offering of sacrifices to himself, yet people continued to speak of the divinity of the emperor. As Pontifex Maximus, he continued to watch over the heathen in worship and protect its rights. As Pontifex Maximus. Remember that this title is given to the popes today too, and it explains the civil or temporal power that the pope executes over man, calling himself the King of Kings. And when I look to the Bible, there's only one King of Kings, and that's Jesus Christ, and certainly not the Pontifex Maximus, Pope in Rome. In dedicating Constantinople in 330 AD, a ceremonial that was half sun worship and half Christian was used. The chariot of the sun god was set in the marketplace and over it the cross. Coins made by Constantine featured the cross, but also representations of Mars or Apollo, who are from ancient Rome. While professing to be a Christian, he continued to believe in sun worship magic formulas for the protection of crops and the healing of diseases. All of these things are pointed out in the Catholic Encyclopedia. Yet, the practice of Constantine, the concept of mixture, which is nothing else than compromise, what Christians, real Bible-believing Christians, should and would never do, was clearly the method whereby the Catholic Church developed and became rich and increased with goods. Constantine's mother, Helena, when nearly 80 years of age, made a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. Legend has it that she found three crosses buried there. See where I'm going? One the cross of Christ, and the other two the ones upon which the thieves were crucified together with Christ. The cross of Christ was identified because it worked miracles of healing at the suggestion of Macarius, Bishop of Jerusalem, while the other two did not. Says an article in the Catholic Encyclopedia, quote, "A portion of the true cross remained at Jerusalem enclosed in a silver reliquary. The remainder, with the nails, must have been sent to Constantine. One of the nails was fastened to the emperor's helmet, and one to his horse's bridle, bringing to pass, according to many of the fathers, what had been written by Zacharias the prophet." Quote from Zacharias 14, verse 20. "In that day shall there be upon the bells of the horses holiness unto the Lord, and the pots in the Lord's house shall be like the bowls before the altar." This same article, while attempting to hold to the general teachings of the Church regarding the cross, admits that the stories about the discovery of the cross vary, and the tradition which actually developed years later may be largely based on legend. That Helena did visit Jerusalem in 326 appears to be historically correct. But the story of her discovery of the cross did not appear until 440. That's about 114 years later. The idea that the original cross would still be at Jerusalem almost 300 years after the crucifixion seems very doubtful. Besides, laws among the Jews required crosses to be burned after being used for crucifixion. Suppose someone were to find the actual cross. This would be of great interest, of course, but would there be any virtue in that piece of wood? No, for the cross has already served its purpose. We recall that, quote, "Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole, and it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten a man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived," as we can read in Numbers 21, verse 9. This was a type of the way Christ was lifted up in death, as we can read in John 3, verse 15, quote, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life, unquote. But after the brass serpent had served its intended purpose, the Israelites kept it around and made an idol out of it. Thus, centuries later, Hezekiah did right that which was right. He brake the images and cut down the groves and brake in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. As we can read in 2 Kings 18 verses 1 through 4, quote, "Now it came to pass in the third year of Hoshea, son of Elah, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. 25 years old was he when he began to reign, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Abi, the daughter of Zechariah. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that David his father did. He removed the high places, and brake the images, and cut down the groves, and brake in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it, and he called it Nehushtan." End quote. Hezekiah did right, not only by destroying heathen idols, but even that which God had ordained, for now it had come to be used in a superstitious and idolatrous way. The Roman Catholic Church is superstitious and idolatrous belief, by the way. On this same basis, if the original cross was still in existence, there would be no reason to set it up as an object of worship. And if there would be no power in the original cross, how much less is there any power in a mere piece of wood in its shape? Even as the Sun sun-worshipping Egyptians had set up obelisks, not only as a symbol of their god, but in some cases the image itself was believed to possess supernatural powers, even so did some come to regard the cross. Had it not helped Constantine in the Battle of Milvian Bridge? Had not the cross worked miracles for Helena? It came to be regarded as an image that could scare away evil spirits. It was worn as a charm. It was placed at the top of church steeples to frighten away lightning. Yet, because of its high position, was the very thing that attracted lightning. The use of the cross in private homes was supposed to ward off trouble and disease. Many pieces of wood, supposedly pieces of the quote-unquote original cross, were sold and exchanged as protectors and charms. We continue now with chapter 8, The Relics of Romanism. The gross superstition that has accompanied the use of relics reveals the deception and inconsistency with which Romanism had been plagued for centuries. Among the most highly venerated relics have been pieces of the quote-unquote true cross. So many of these were scattered throughout Europe and other parts of the world that Calvin once said that if all pieces were gathered together, they would form a good shipload. Yet the cross of Christ was carried by one individual, our Lord and Savior himself. Are we to believe that these pieces miraculously multiplied as when Jesus blessed the loaves and fishes? Such was apparently the belief of St. Paulinus, who spoke of, quote, the redintegration of the cross, that it never grew smaller in size, no matter how many pieces were detached from it, unquote. Calvin mentioned numerous inconsistencies regarding the use of relics, such as several churches claimed to have the crown of thorns, others the water pots used by Jesus in the miracle at Cana. Some of the wine was to be found at Orléans. Concerning a piece of broiled fish Peter offered Jesus, Calvin said, quote, "It must have been wondrously well salted, if it has kept for such a long series of ages," unquote. The crib of Jesus was exhibited for veneration every Christmas Eve at St. Mary Major's in Rome. Several churches claimed to have the baby clothes of Jesus. The Church of St. James in Rome displayed the altar on which Jesus was placed when he was presented in the temple. Even the foreskin from his circumcision was shown by the monks of Charu, who, as a proof of a genuineness, declared that it yielded drops of blood. Churches at Coulomb in France, St. John's in Rome, and the Church of Puy-Velay also claimed to have the foreskin in their possessions. So how many foreskins does a man have? Other relics include Joseph's carpenter's tools, bones of the donkey on which Jesus rode into Jerusalem, the cup used at the Last Supper, the empty purse of Judas, Pilate's basin, the coat of purple thrown over Jesus by the mocking soldiers, the sponge lifted to him on the cross, nails from the cross, specimens of the hair of the Virgin Mary. Now, some brown, some blonde, some red, and some black. Her skirts, her wedding ring. But please, Mary was married in the biblical way to Joseph, meaning they had no rings. That would be a Roman wedding. But also her slippers, her veil, and even a bottle of the milk on which Jesus had been suckled. Well, maybe it was of one of Jesus' brothers. How can they tell the difference? Because Jesus had brothers and sisters born after that he was born, when Mary and Joseph really conceived the marriage, as it is written in the book. According to Catholic belief, Mary's body was taken to heaven. But several different churches in Europe did claim to have the body of Mary's mother, even though we know nothing about her, and she was not even given the name Saint Anne until a few centuries ago. Even more difficult is the story about Mary's house. Now, it becomes really ridiculous. Catholics believe that the house in which Mary lived at Nazareth is now in the little town of Loreto, Italy, having been transported there by angels. The Catholic Encyclopedia says, quote, "Since the 15th century, and possibly even earlier, the Holy House of Loreto has been numbered among the most famous shrines of Italy. The interior measures only 31 feet by 13. An altar stands at one end beneath a statue, blackened with age, of the Virgin Mother and her divine infant, venerable throughout the world on account of the divine mysteries accomplished in it. It is here that that Most Holy Mary, Mother of God, was born. Here that she was saluted by the angel. Here that the Eternal Word was made flesh. Angels conveyed interior of Holy House at Loreto, this house from Palestine, to the town of Tersato in Illyria in the year of salvation 1291 AD, in the pontificate of Pope Nicholas IV. 3 years later, in the beginning of the pontificate of Boniface VIII, oh, what an huge Antichrist he was, it was carried again by the ministry of angels and placed in a wood, where, having changed its station thrice in the course of a year, at length, by the will of God, it took up its permanent position on this spot. That the traditions thus boldly proclaimed to the world have been fully sanctioned by the Holy See cannot for a moment remain in doubt. More than 47 popes have in various ways rendered honor to the shrine, and an immense number of bulls and briefs proclaim, without qualification, the identity of the Santa Casa di Loreto with the Holy House of Nazareth." End quote from the Roman Catholic Encyclopedia. What a load of BS! and BS stands for lies. The veneration of dead bodies of martyrs was ordered by the Council of Trent, the council which also condemned those who did not believe in relics. Quote, "The holy bodies of holy martyrs are to be venerated by the faithful, for through these bodies many benefits are bestowed by God on men, so that they who affirm that veneration and honor are not due to the relics of the saints, are wholly to be condemned, as the Church has already long since condemned and also now condemns them." End quote. Because it was believed that many benefits could come through the bones of dead men, the sale of bodies and bones became very, very big business. In about 750 AD, long lines of wagons constantly came to Rome, bringing immense quantities of skulls and skeletons, which were sorted, labeled, and sold by the popes. Graves were plundered by night, and tombs and churches were watched by armed men. Rome, says Gregorius, was, quote, "like a mouldering cemetery in which hyenas howled and fought as they dug greedily after corpses," unquote. There is in the church of St. Presidi a marble slab which states that in 817 Pope Pascal had the bodies of 2,300 martyrs transferred from cemeteries to this church. When Pope Boniface IV converted the Pantheon into a Christian church about 609, again mixing the holy with the profane, again putting a Christian garment on pagan relics, quote, 28 cartloads of sacred bones were said to have been removed from the catacombs and placed in a porphyry basin beneath the high altar. A porphyry basin is what is being used to baptize in the church. Placing bones beneath a church or other relics were required to, quote-unquote, consecrate the ground and building. The castle church at Wittenberg, to the door of which Luther nailed his famous 95 Theses, had 19,000 saintly relics. Bishops were forbidden by the Second Nicene Council in 787 AD to dedicate a building if no relics were present. The penalty for so doing was excommunication. Were these ideas taken from the Bible, or were they taken from Sun sun worship? In the old legends, when Nimrod, the false savior of Babylon, died, his body was torn limb from limb, part being buried one place and part another. When he was, quote-unquote, resurrected, becoming the Sun sun god, it was taught that he was now in a different body, the members of the old body being left behind. This is in contrast to the death of the true Savior, Jesus Christ, of whom it was prophesied, "A bone of him shall not be broken," as we read in John 19, verse 36. Quote, "For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, a bone of him shall not be broken." Unquote. And who was resurrected in the true sense of the word. The resurrection of Christ resulted in an empty tomb, no parts of his body being left behind for relics. In the old mystery religion, the various places where it was believed a bone of their god was buried were considered sacred, consecrated by a bone. Quote, "Egypt was covered with sepulchres of its martyred god, and many a leg and arm and skull, all vouched to be genuine, were exhibited in the rival burying places for the adoration of the Egyptian faithful." Unquote. The influence of Egypt on the children of Israel is evidenced in their setting up the golden calf. Since Egypt was a place of multiplied relics, the wisdom of God in the secret burial of Moses is apparent, as we can read in Deuteronomy 34, verse 6. Quote, And he buried him in a valley in the land of Moab, over against Beth Peor. But no man knoweth of his sepulchre unto this day. Unquote. Since no one knew the place of his burial and no sacred pilgrimages could be made to his tomb, years later the brass serpent that Moses made was named Nehustan, as we already read in the chapter before, and was worshipped as a sacred relic by the Israelites. And we can read that in 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 4, quote, "He removed the high places and brake the images and cut down the groves and break in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it, and he called it Nehustan." You remember me reading that a few minutes ago in chapter 7. If such idolatry was practiced with something Moses made, how much deeper in idolatry would they have gone had they possessed one of his bones? It is evident that the use of relics is very ancient and did not originate with Christianity. The Catholic Encyclopedia rightly says that the use of, quote, "of some object, notably part of the body or clothes, remaining as a memorial of a departed saint," unquote, was in existence, quote, "before the propagation of Christianity," unquote, and, quote, "the veneration of relics, in fact, is to some extent a primitive instinct associated with many other religious systems besides that of Christianity," unquote. If Christ and the apostles did not use relics, but the use of such was known prior to Christianity and among other religions, do we not have another example of a S-U-N sun worship idea being, quote-unquote, Christianized? The Roman Catholic Church, my dear brothers and sisters, worships death. It's a death cult, and their god is a dead one, Satan. Why don't people see that? Proof is all over the place, and even the Catholic Encyclopedia is not short of words for it. We do not see that relics have any part in true worship, for, quote, "God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth," unquote, from John 4, verse 24. The extremism to which the use of relics has led is certainly not, quote-unquote, truth. Some of the bones that were at one time acclaimed as the bones of saints have been exposed as the bones of animals. In Spain, a cathedral once displayed what was said to be part of a wing of the angel Gabriel when he visited Mary. Upon investigation, however, it was found to be a magnificent ostrich feather. It is not necessary to labor long on this point. The Catholic Encyclopedia, once again, itself recognizes that many relics are doubtful. Quote, "Many of the more ancient relics duly exhibited for veneration in the great sanctuaries of Christendom or even at Rome itself must now be pronounced to be either certainly spurious or open to grave suspicion. Difficulties might be urged against the supposed, quote, column of the flagellation, unquote, venerated at Rome in the church of Santa Prassede, and against many other famous relics," unquote. The important relic of the column of flagellation was transported from Jerusalem to Rome by John Cardinal Colonna, one of the leaders of the Sixth Crusade, in the year 1223, and was put up in his title church of St. Praxedes, which means Santa Prassede in Italian, in the oratory of St. Zenon. It is of jasper marble with white, black, and green specks. How, then, is this discrepancy explained? The Catholic Encyclopedia once again continues, quote, "No dishonor is done to God by the continuance of an error." which has been handed down in perfect good faith for many centuries. Really? Really? Hence, there is justification for the practice of the Holy See in allowing the cult of certain doubtful ancient relics to continue. Unquote. But again, we would point out that true worship is in spirit and in truth, not by the continuance of an error. Bravo! If the author wouldn't have written it, I would have certainly stated that here. We would point out that true worship is in spirit and in truth, not by the continuance of an error. Even if we did have one of Mary's hairs, or a bone of the Apostle Paul, or the robe of Jesus, would God be pleased with these things being set up as objects of worship? Well, Exodus 20, verse 4 to 6, quote, "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me, and keep my commandments." End quote. Keep my commandments even up to this day. It is clearly stated in the Word of God what He commands concerning relics, which are idols. According to the example of the brass serpent of Moses, the author continues, and comes to the conclusion, of God, cause God would not. We can only ask, if there would be no real virtue in the actual hair, bone, or robe, how much less merit can there be in relics which are known to be fakes? There is no merit in any relic, whether it is genuine or it is not. There is no merit in any idol, in any relic taken from the earth or from the heaven, or from the waters under the earth. So, two very interesting chapters, and chapter 9, called Religious Fraud, will go on with even more exposing of the Roman Catholic lies taught all over the world, and not only in Roman Catholic churches, my dear brethren, but also throughout all the so-called quote-unquote denominations, the so-called Protestant churches of today, who are all infiltrated by the Jesuits, and all, almost all, today, 2016, signed agreements with the Roman Catholic Church, like the Catholic Lutheran Accords from 1999, which the Methodist Church also signed in 2004. You want to know more about that? Go to my playlist Hour of the Truth, and the very first broadcasts on Hour of the Truth dealt with an in-deep explanation to show to you how the Lutheran Church, who dare still use the name of the great reformer, came back under the wings of Rome in 1999. What does that tell you when you are part of any denomination, of any organized church out there? It tells you exactly what is spoken of in Revelation 18, verse 4. It tells you that I heard another voice from heaven saying, "Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. And if you don't want to be part of God's wrath, come out of her, my people. So, thank you very much for listening and watching this video. Looking forward to your comments. And I will not take such a long break until I read and continue in this book, Babylon Mystery Religion, the original book Ralph Woodrow wrote in chapter 9 called Religious Fraud. Until then, may God bless you and keep you in his ways and keep you in the truth and keep you on the right path. Until next time, God bless you all. And Juggler 66, Hour of the Truth, signing off. Bye-bye.